that, it's not this sort of closed society where, where people are, only listen to what their regime says and are shut up from the world. It's not that kind of society. Very modern, 70% youth. And what the regime didn't achieve in 1988 with killing off all the communists. I remember when I was in prison, actually, one prison guard said, "Where did you guys come from? I thought, we killed them all, once." He said, I actually said, like, communism is what kind of is like a microbe that somehow always grows. Because 88 said, "We killed them all, we finished everything." They really thought they finished everything, right? My mom or a lot of people who were not even communists but sort of different leftist groups who had been in prison and stuff were so scared for years that they wouldn't even tell us. Like, I didn't learn about socialism from my parents. They never told us because, they were so scared of the idea that, that they could tell us they were socialists that they wouldn't even talk about it. But this idea grew again because there was a thirst for it. And sort of the final words, looking at the current movement and where is it going? The movement obviously had a lot of similarities to Egypt. What went wrong in Iran, you would say, is that the regime was, and we have to be clear, luck does play a role in history, sort of the specific circumstances. The Islamic regime was tougher at the beginning. People did gather, We created a lot of Tahrir squares in our own Azadia Square. For some reason, all these dictatorial regimes don't have a shortage of, streets and squares named after freedom and liberation and stuff. But as I was saying, in the beginning, we created a lot of Tahrir squares. The movement actually massively, really heroically went forward for a long time. It stopped. There was a point of a stop, you could say, after, or a stop is not a very good word. There's a better English word that commoners use, but I forgot it. Sort of when something doesn't stop, but it temporarily.
Stops.
Yeah, something like that. There we go. Yeah, but there was a better word, but I don't remember it.
Hiatus.
There we go. But basically, after Ashura, which you remember, there was a day that. It's a day of Shia, usual Shia mourning. It's the killing of martyrdom and killing of and Shia Imam. But on that day, the massive demonstrations led to fight with Basij. By the way, all these sort of your typical bourgeois leadership of this movement was saying, people, oh no, be nice, don't do things, stay deaf to nobody. Well, how nice is that? People didn't stay deaf to nobody, they said deaf to Khamenei, deaf to dictator. On that day, they fought the police, they fought the cops, the thugs, and the movement was really escalating, however, without no leadership. I talked to commoners who said, we had the streets, we, on that day, if somebody just said, do something with the streets, we had the leadership, we vote everybody off, it was us. But without the leadership, they took a step back. One thing that really gave breath again to Iranian revolution was the Arab revolution, of course. People saying that was possible, the misleaders of the Iranian revolution, I would say, Mr. Mousavi and them had to call a day of solidarity, sort of a, half-assed thing. But then people came and said, okay, we'll come this Tuesday, then we'll come next Tuesday, the International Women's Day. Then last Tuesday of the year, which we is our fire festival, we'll come out that day. There were attempts again, but what is fundamental now? You can be sure that there will be a rupture again. There would be a attack of people on the regime again. But two things are very fundamental now that will make our job easier. Number one, the subsidy cuts that the regime has put, which have really brought masses of much more sort of everyday normal people to the movement as well. And not only that, but also the kind of demands. It's not very clear that Ahmadinejad is the government of IMF in Iran too. It's a shame I didn't get to sort of talk about that part. But Obama's strategy in Iran has always been to, keep the Islamic Republic, for them to be some kind of a new ally for us. The role they did help the US imperialism in Afghanistan and Iraq, by the way. But there are different kind of helps. In Iraq, obviously, it was you know, giving a slap to Americans sometimes, but saying, look, you know, we can work together, we can be respectable allies in the region. But anyways, so there is that the economic attacks on the workers makes very clear what kind of regime this is, and it has led to mass, it has really led to much differences in Iranian society. I was talking to my grandmother the other day, and this is a, you know, we used to always go there for Fridays, you know, after they come back from Friday prayers, we would go, we would have, you know, our traditional meals and sit together. And I said, hey, grandma, you know, I would love to come and do that now. And she said, well, you know, since the last 2-3 months, we are not really able to do that. You know, your grandfather gets just so much, you know, seniority pay and what you call pension. And the price of meat and rice and all has risen so much that, you know, we can't really invite people over anymore. And these are people who have been done this for generations. You know, she would always say, this house has been thrice, this has happened in Friday since, like, what, 100 years ago. And this had to stop. So really changes in society and movements, resistant movements on the part of the people. And the other very important major difference are the ruptures between leaders. Khamenei and Ahmadinejad, the president and the supreme leader, which were supposed to be best buddies. And this was a very small part of the regime leadership. Like, they were supposed to be best buddies against all the other parts, 90%, 95% of the regime. But now they have had a huge outbreak again, not sort of time to go into it. You know, look for it in the news if you are interested in this. But it is a real funny thing. I mean, when Lenin says one of the conditions of revolution is disunity of the in the ruling class, I think one of the most graphic, beautiful examples of that is in Iran, because you see all this mass of people who are supposed to be, you know, united in the top of regime, and they are all fighting each other in the papers. In the papers, you can easily in a newspaper in Iran, and I still write for them, by the way, with different names. You can go write an editorial and really criticize the Ahmadinejad. If they ask you what, you say, well, obviously I'm doing it on from the perspective of the, you know, supreme leader. But, you know, you can just say, what is this government? Our prices are like this, or, you know, and then say, oh, you know, I actually meant from, you know, supreme leaders is the same thing. How can you criticize me? And they do, they do that. So very important, this regime cannot stand the tide of the revolution coming in anymore. It's a matter of months or years before it collapses. But that, as Fred said, and I'll finish with this, as Fred said earlier, what we are trying to do is to build a communist force who can be different this time, who can lead the revolution to a different conclusion this time. Now, the Iranian communist youth, when I began, I said, you know, the title, what do we say, what do we want? Well, number one, we are very humble. We don't believe that masses will just come to us. We believe we are one of the ideas present in the labor movement and in the revolutionary movement. But we are confident in our ideas at the same time. You know, there's this thing about the youth that, you know, they have certain proud, but we hope to mix it with certain humbleness as well. That we say to American workers and to workers and youth around the world, that the best way they can help the Iranian revolution, of course, is to go fight the US imperialism, and the best way to do that is to, you know, take part in the great movements here. That as much as the workers in Wisconsin can say they were interested in the movement in Egypt, workers in Iran were interested in the US state of Wisconsin. Every day, like, I was in Wisconsin passing yesterday, and I was on my computer talking to some people from Iran, and every single person who I said I'm passing a state of Wisconsin said, oh, you mean when they had the demonstrations in the city of Madison? One person also asked me if that's the same city as the movie of the bridges of Madison County. And these are the people who have never left Iran. So you see this, you know, the American stuff are popular in Iran as well. And so I would finish with this, saying the Iranian papers are evil. Obviously, our Iranian comrades can read them, but also the other ones. If, you know, we would love to have your support. Every dollar in the United States goes a long way in Iran when we send it for the comrades back home or for different activities that we have. You could take it as a souvenir. Yeah, I think it makes a nice souvenir. nobody reads it, but well, our English stuff are on Marxist.com. And I'll say that the Iranian communist youth are are trying to be determined and real valiant in our efforts. And if you saw those pictures of Iranian workers and you demonstrating in the early months of revolution, we always say to ourselves, whenever we have a meeting and the questions of comrades, the task is hard. Now, when are you ready? Are you ready to go back when the regime falls? Our answers are yes. We say, if we get 1/10, 1/100 of the determination and the courage that the Iranian masses have had in the last 30 years, but especially shorter, in those 2 years, I think we will be well ready toward our goal. Yes.